I was at six figures. I wish I had this training. I wish I had known the right steps to hiring. I wish I had known about brains and hands, and when the right time was to hire those people. Yo, what is up, you guys? Andrew Cruzy here again with another epic training on how you can build out your seven-figure team, specifically how to remove yourself as the bottleneck of your business by assembling the brains for your machine. And we're gonna dive into this epic training in just a second here. I'm gonna wait for some people to pop on. But this is what really lights me up. This is what really jazzes me up is talking about assembling your team, because it has allowed me to live in my zone of genius, to get out of burnout, to really enjoy what I'm doing so much more. Because I'm going to tell my story in a second here, but I went through a period of time where I was successful. I was doing 40, 50K per month, but I burnt out. I had no support. And I was doing everything myself. So if you're in that spot right now where you are just dragging, you're wondering, oh, who's the next person I should hire? Or who's the first person I should hire? How can I get myself out from doing everything? You're in the right spot, especially if you're a coach or consultant. Those are the people that we help the most. And if you want to go faster, if you want to learn directly from me, if you want me to coach you, just hashtag coach down below and we can talk about our programs and how they might be able to help you. This is gonna be sweet training. I'm gonna hop on Facebook right now to see who we have on here. And let's check it out. And yes, we've got eight people on here. If you are live with us, hashtag live down below so I can give you a shout out and see your beautiful face. And once we got a few people doing that, we will hop into the training. And if you're watching the replay, hashtag replay down below. The more engagement we get, the more people can reach, more people we can help. And we'll hop into this in just a second. If you get any value out of this along the way, hit that heart button, hit that like button. And if I don't see anybody comment, I'm not going to start. Who wants to start this off? Ravi, do you want to start this off by hashtagging live down below? Not starting until I get some fucking engagement. What's up, Ravi? Good to see you. There's no engagement. Not going to fucking do it. Chris, how are you, buddy? Get psyched up for the training here. Hit that hashtag live down below, or I'm not getting started. There we go. Joelle, there we go, man. We will get started. Chris, good to see you. And let's hop into the training here. So, like I said, seven-figure team training, how to start removing yourself as the bottleneck of your business by assembling the brains of your machine. So what I always like to start off with these trainings is a little quote from Andrew Carnegie here. Teamwork is the ability to work together towards a common vision, the ability to direct individual accomplishments towards organizational objectives. It is the fuel that allows common people to attain uncommon results. So if you're looking to build an empire, if you're looking to make a massive impact on this world, you're going to need to assemble a team to do it. That's how you attain uncommon results by having a unit directed towards a common vision to accomplish a goal. So that's what we're going to be talking about here today. And just start off, when I was starting out, when I was at six figures, I wish I had this training. I wish I had known the right steps to to hiring. I wish I had known about brains and hands, and when the right time was to hire those people, because I was hitting a wall. I was doing everything myself, and I thought more effort of doing was going to get me to the next level, but it was actually doing less, taking a step back, looking at what my vision was for the company, and looking at who I needed in my company to be able to help us get to that vision. And when I started to do that, that's when we started to ultimately scale so much faster. You're not going to be able to go to seven figures, especially you're not going to be able to make the impact that you can make going to seven figures if you don't have a team, if you don't have a rock solid team. And so in 2019, I started assembling my team. I hired Avery Ford as our creative director to help me with coaching, help me with delivery. And I started getting things off my plate like crazy. And then I hired Grant, who is in charge of sales. And I'll talk more about this later on. But we were able to do our first $1 million year as soon as I started hiring brains and hands. So we're going to be hopping into that. And nowadays, we did 2.5 million in 2020. We're going to do about 5 to 6 million in 2021 here. We're super excited about it, and it wouldn't be possible without the team here. So here's some problems that you might be experiencing. You don't know the simplest org chart you can make for the best results. You have a team of doers, but not a team of thinkers, which is real leverage. And you're in charge of just about every strategy, KPI target, and results in every department of your business. So let's talk about the promise of this training. You'll know the simplest way to build out your team for the best results. You'll know exactly what hat you should be wearing in your business right now. And you'll know exactly who your next A player hire should be. So, if we're ready to hop into this, hit a one down below if you're excited about this training and getting this going together. If you have a team right now, hashtag team down below. I would love to see who here already has a team assembled. How many people on your team? So, if you have three people on your team, put a three, team three down below, something like that. Chris, one, just you, buddy. Oh, wait, no. Yeah, if you're ready to hop into it, hit that one. It's kind of delayed. Sure, I love it. Thanks for the hashtag lives. If you get any value out of this along the way, hit that heart button, hit that like button. And let me know, team, small team, Joe, sweet three, amazing. Who's on your team? Let me know. Do you have an executive assistant? Do you have a salesperson? Stephanie, too, including me. All good. You're at a great spot. All right. Thanks for the engagement. Love it. Love chatting with you guys. So let's hop into it. Let's talk about the process to go from the problems to the promise. So here's what we'll cover, the difference between brains and hands. And then we're going to talk about the brain structure that will help you scale past seven or even eight figures. And then how to assemble the brains in your business. So, brains versus hands. What are brains? What are hands? So, brains are the department heads of operations, marketing, sales, and delivery, who are responsible for the strategy, the KPIs, the key performance indicators, the execution, and the results of their department. So brains essentially equal your leadership team. And hands are the contractors and employees who are responsible for the execution of the strategy and hitting the KPI targets for each department. They report directly to the brains, right? So if you're going from zero to six figures, you probably are just able to afford hands. I just had an executive assistant, And mind you, I did not know how to work with my executive assistant at the time. I didn't know how to get the most out of her. I didn't know how to lead her. And I wish I had Authority Accelerator or Seven Figure CEO or programs at the time to be able to lead my team. But 0 to 6 figures, you're just looking at really being able to afford hands. And we're going to talk about this in a second. When you're going from 0 to 6 figures, it's sweat equity, it's hustle, it's about building up cash flow so you can invest into your brains when you're going from 6 to 7 figures, right? So then from 6 to 7 figures, you want to start hiring brains that will also be responsible for the strategy of the department and a lot of the execution. When you're scaling from 7 to multiple 7 figures, those brains can step more out of the execution and really be the brain, really be the strategy of the department. But going from 6 to 7 figures, they are going to be a brain and they're also going to be in charge of the execution as well, a little bit of the execution in each department, right? So the brain structure. So does that make sense? Are you guys with me on brains and hands? Pop it down below. Love this example. Awesome. Cool. Perfect. So let's talk about the brain structure here that will help you scale past 7, 8 figures. So, brain structure here, you've got your CEO on top, and we're going to be going over this one by one in a second here. Below that is the ops manager or the COO. And then you've got your head of marketing, your head of sales, your head of delivery. So, the responsibility of the brain, like we talked about, the strategy, the KPI, the execution, and the results of the department that they run. So, CEO, what are they responsible for? CEO is responsible for vision and high-level strategy. So, you are in charge of telling your team where you're going, why you're going there, what the values are of your company, and helping build out the strategy to get there, the high-level strategy to ultimately get there. What people you need on your team, kind of what we're talking about here. And ultimately, you're the business owner, so you need to be responsible at a high level. These are just a few KPIs here. You're always going to be responsible for revenue, profit, and profit margin here. So then the ops manager or the COO, what are they responsible for? They're the one who delegates the CEO's vision and keeps the machine, your business, running efficiently. They are all about the efficiency of which your business runs, right? So some KPIs, these are just high-level KPIs, and there are a bunch more to go over, and we go over those inside of Seven Figure CEO. But labor efficiency ratio, being able to nail down a number to determine how much efficiency, how much you're getting out of your team, right? And being able to put a number on that. Overdue tasks, project status, really nailing into the projects and what's on task, what's off task, that sort of stuff, and watching those numbers. Marketing, they're responsible for driving lead generation and growth. So some numbers they're responsible for: new sales revenue, marketing ROI, client acquisition costs, and list goes on and on and on. This isn't a video about KPIs right now. We have another video of that inside of Seven Figure CEO, but these are just some ideas of KPIs. Then sales, they're responsible for converting sales at the highest percentage. So KPIs they're responsible for: sales revenue, close percentage, number of new clients. And then delivery, they're responsible for delivering on the promise and turning clients into raving fans. So some KPIs that your head of delivery will be responsible for: net promoter score. So if you guys don't know what net promoter score, it's a great number to determine how much your clients like your offer. And it's very, very simple. You can look it up on Google too. Net promoter score is essentially a survey that says, hey, on a scale from 1 to 10, how likely are you to refer our service to somebody else? And you're able to nail down a number that way and really get a clear picture of how satisfied your clients are with your program. And then other things, number of red status clients, if that's how you determine if somebody is like at risk of falling off, and churn percentage, just some KPIs there for you. So, now that we talked about that, we need to talk about where you fit into this equation right now. So, really, really good book, The Road Less Stupid by Keith Cunningham. And let me know if you have read this book, Road Less Stupid. If you haven't gotten it, highly recommend getting it on Amazon right now. For that CEO mindset, this is one of the best books that you can buy. But Keith Cunningham has this methodology or this graphic here of the four hats of business, right? So as a person at the head of our business, we're wearing one of these hats right now, right? So we're either wearing the artist hat, the operator hat, the owner hat, or the board hat, right? And when we're starting out our businesses, a lot of times we're wearing that artist hat. It's about passion. It's about making it fun. It's about starting it and loving the idea, right? And the outcome ultimately is fulfillment. And it's kind of a hobby, and we're a little bit like just dabbling. And our motto is, it's not fun, I'm not doing it, right? But over time, we start to transition. We're like, oh, I want to make this a business. I want to make money out of it. And we start to move to the operator hat or the technician, right? And we really value time and effort, right? Putting in that sweat equity. Some of you guys might be there right now where you are just starting your business and you're just like, let's work. Let's get this done. Let's get this going. And you might be a little overwhelmed with too much information because you just want to get there faster. That's why you need a proven roadmap. And that's why you need a coach that has done it before. And if you don't join our program, Seven Figure CEO or Authority Accelerator, join somebody else's that you really trust and like. But that's how I've been able to grow so fast and get out of the operator role because I've hired people. I've spent my last dollars on programs with a proven roadmap to get out of the operator role where it was all me, right? So when you're in the operator seat or wearing that hat, it's all about controlling it, having control over everything, right? And your strategy is just do it. I'm just going to do it. For me, it was I'm just going to post in Facebook and I'm going to respond to these conversations. I'm going to book the sales call and I'm going to deliver for this client. Did everything, right? And the outcome is the business runs you. And you just get overwhelmed by your own business if you stay in this seat for too or wear this hat for too long. And the motto is, if it's going to get done, then I have to do it. And I see so many CEOs live in this seat for way too long. And what you need to do is move to the owner role, right? This is what we're talking about here with where you really value leverage and measuring it, right? And being able to read KPIs and know where you're at in your business and be able to structure your machine in a way that you can lead it. Right? You can just coach your team to be more efficient and grow it. And you run the business now. Instead of you getting overwhelmed and doing everything, then you run the business. And the motto here is measure results and change activities. So measure results, see how things are going, look at your dashboard, look at your KPIs, and see what you can see what the next strategic move is from there and changing activities to see how the numbers change, right? And then ultimately, the last hat is the board member or the investor. And this is where you value thinking and thinking, what don't I see? And really valuing the kind of more visionary role of the machine is running. Now I'm at the top. And I'm just making these very strategic changes by valuing thinking time. The plan is to keep it, and the strategy is to sustain it. So it doesn't die off, right? And the outcome is asset allocation and risk. And those are the four hats. So I would love for you to put down below, Stephanie, thank you so much for engaging here. Put down below, what hat are you currently wearing in your business? And Gia, I see you. Alvin, Brian, good to see you guys. Dre, thanks for being here, dude. Let me know down below, what hat are you currently wearing in your business? Is it the artist hat, the operator hat, the owner hat, or the board hat? All four at once, Stephanie. All of them. What is your main hat that you're wearing right now? What do you really value? What do you really value right now? Right? Drop it down below. Joel, good to see you. Everybody's just saying all good. All right. So your next question is probably, how do I assemble brains in my business? So starting out a new business from scratch forces you to wear the artist hat and the operator hat. But as your focus when you're starting out should be on cash, traction, and operational structure, right? So it should be on getting as much cash on hand as possible, gaining the traction in the marketplace, nailing down your messaging and your offers, and operational structure mainly around marketing and sales, right? So really nailing down your marketing and sales strategy. And when you're scaling up, once you have that cash on hand, once you have your messaging and offers nailed down, once you have your operational structure around sales and marketing and delivery nailed in, and a vision for your business, you start moving towards the owner or CEO hat, right? So you're focused on leverage and measuring. So, i.e., it's time to assemble those brains. And when you're transitioning from the operator to the CEO or the owner hat, the questions you should be asking yourself are, what's my department of genius, right? What's my zone of genius? Where do I want to live? What department drains the most of my energy, right? And what department takes the majority of my time? And answering these questions will help you identify what is the first department that you should start getting off your plate? And what department do you want to hold on until that is the last department you want to hold on to, right? Determined by what your department of genius is. So your first brain hire should be in delivery or operations department, usually, right? This will free up more of your time for revenue generating activities and focusing on the departments that are going to bring in more cash flow. So I'm going to talk about this in a second, but my first hire, my brain hire was in the delivery department with Avery, right? And that allowed me to free up more of my time to focus it on marketing and sales, bring in more cash flow so I could hire more brains, right? And what's super important is you do not want to hire two brains at the same time. That is a recipe for disaster. It will take 2 to 3 months to really ramp up a brain to speed so they can own their department. So hire one brain at a time. So when you're hiring a brain, ask yourself, this is a super critical question. If you're scaling to seven figures, ask yourself, is this person seven-figure caliber? It's a very binary yes. This person can help us get to seven figures and is the best solution to get us to seven figures, or they're not. And it's crazy how much we don't ask ourselves these simple little questions that will determine if this is a good hire or not a good hire. And if you're scaling from seven figures to eight figures, asking yourself, is this person eight-figure caliber? And these are really good questions to keep on your mind because sometimes when you're scaling past seven figures, those people that are with you aren't the same people that are going to help you scale past eight figures. Unless they're keeping up and they're constantly innovating, a lot of times those people aren't the people that are going to help you get to eight figures. So you've also got to ask this question about your current team members. Once you're scaling up, is this person the next level? Can they help us get to the next level, right? So here's how I transitioned from operator to CEO, right? So in April of 2018, I hired Tasha, my executive assistant. She was my first hand, and she helped me get things off my plate. Then April of 2019, I hired Grant, who was another hand at the time. He started to develop a little bit into a brain, but he was more of a hand. He was driving more sales. He was driving more revenue because cash is the lifeblood of your business. We needed more cash to hire the brain, which in May, I hired Avery, who's our brain. And then January 2020, hired Paul for ops. March 2020, hired a sales brain, Mitchell. And then in June of 2020, hired Jimmy, our marketing brain, was able to build out that system. So the brains for each department of the business, right? So that is it. I hope this gave you a clear idea of what brains and hands are, how you can start transitioning out of your machine and really build your machine. I am open for Q&A for anybody that has questions for me. If you got anything out of this, hit that heart button, hit that like button. The more engagement we get, the more trainings I'll do in here like this. And I hope it was super helpful. So we got some questions here. Joelle, it's hard to efficiently let go when bootstrapping. Yes, that's why from zero to six figures, it's all about traction and focusing in on one offer. It's so hard to just like think, I need to focus in on one offer and stick to it. But ultimately, simplicity scales. And the more you can narrow down your messaging, narrow down your offers, and focus on one marketing channel going from zero to six figures, the more likely you are to get to that point where you're building up cash on hand and not bootstrapping as much. Good question though. Stephanie, before we go buy the yacht, what is the recommended cash on hand to transition? You need to look at how much it's going to cost for the hire. Like, what's the return on investment? How much is it going to cost for this hire? And you want to build up to a place where you have 3 to 6 months. I don't know who's doing, somebody's doing construction up there. But you want to have 3 to 6 months worth of expenses on hand to be able to hire that person. So if it's a $5,000 a month person, and you don't have $15,000 to $30,000 in the bank, there is no way you should hire that person. And in your business account, not your personal account. So start with an executive assistant, somebody who can get things off your plate 5 to 10 hours per week, paying them $10 to $25 per hour based on skill set. And then, like I said, from zero to six figures, it's about hiring hands. So your next hire should be somebody who helps you with sales, whether that is a setter or whether that is a setter closer or a closer. Right. And then they will help you build up more revenue. And then your next hire should be an accountability coach, somebody that can help you stabilize delivery a little bit. And then you should be able to move on to the hands or to the brains. Right. Meg, thanks for being here. This is awesome. I'm looking to hire a sales rep, but I'm very scared I'll hire someone and then they'll do a bad job. Yeah, that's definitely possible. What you're going to want is the best training for that salesperson. And what we do inside of Seven Figure CEOs, we actually train your team. Your team comes in, they come to our group coaching calls, and they have all of our video material on how to sell or how to coach or how to be an operator. So you want that support there. But my biggest recommendation is make sure you have those constant feedback loops and touch points. So when you're hiring a new salesperson, you've got to, number one, give yourself 2 months of letting them ramp up and get up to speed. And you've got to meet with them every single day as they're ramping up so you can help them optimize. Where people fail is like lack of communication with their team and lack of helping them optimize and get better, right? How do you hire talent? Do you hire HR? Thank you. So we have an HR team, but they don't do the hiring. They do more of the legal side of things. But it depends on where you're at in your journey and how you're hiring. So when you're starting out, everything is about building up network. Our best hires have come from my network. I've joined half dozen masterminds in the past 2 years and built up my network. And the best question you can ask is who is the most talented person whom we should hire for marketing or for sales or for operations? And building up your talent bench. And like as a CEO, you should always be connecting to the best talent. So when you have an open spot on your team, you've already had that conversation with that person, right? There's a lot of like teaching on like, hey, this is how you post on Indeed, or this is how you go to Fiverr and you're not gonna find the best person there. You're gonna find the best people through your network. And when you hire A players, they refer you to more A players, right? So don't go cheap on your team, because if you hire the best talent, they will introduce you to the best talent, right? I hired Avery, and then I was introduced to Brad, and then I was introduced to Aaron, and they're all A players, but they came from me hiring A players initially, right? And for the hands hires, we have what are called hiring funnels. I can show you real quick here. So this is a hiring funnel. Hey, we're hiring sales professionals, blah, blah, blah. This is what you get at our company. And then here's the application. And we blast out emails, we send out social media posts to get more people to this application, and to ultimately go through our interviewing process. So hiring funnels, if you don't have a hiring funnel and you're at six figures, you need to set up your first one and start getting people on your talent bench. Will your coaching help people in real estate investing? So if you're a real estate investing coach, yes. We have Jen and Stacy Conkey who started with us, and they didn't even have an online program. They were just going to in-person events, or they had like just in-person events, kind of lower ticket thing. And they scaled from basically nothing to they just did over $200,000 last month, and they built $1 million business in less than a year with our support. And they worked hard. They went all in on their business. There were no shortcuts, but they followed our processes and our roadmap, and were able to build $1 million business from essentially nothing online in less than a year. So yeah, we've helped a lot of people like Shane Hillier. He's in the real estate investing space. Chad Lauer, he started with us and went from 20, 30K per month to 90K per month in just a couple months. So we've helped a lot of people in the real estate investing space. So good question. All right. So that's about my time, you guys. Thank you so much for being here. I hope this was helpful. If you got any value out of it, hit that heart button, hit that like button, and keep coming back. I enjoyed this, and I'll talk to you guys soon. Oh, wait, we got one more question. So, Joel, what would you tell somebody that is in two niches? I would say don't split your focus. It's gonna be hard. Pick one niche, go all in on that, and focus on one ideal client, dude. You'll scale much faster that way. But cool, sweet, much love. I'll talk to you guys. Have a great weekend, and see you soon.